Good morning.
Good morning.
Here we are again. And after meandering off the first chapter of Jeremiah for a few weeks, we're back to where we were before, the Gospels. Specifically the Gospel of Luke, which, if you'll remember, is how we closed last year and opened this one. As we journeyed through Christmas, you'll remember, we talked about God's glory, His gravity, how that's what's missing from our world, a genuine centeredness on God. But we've long since fallen away from His orbit and closed our eyes to His beauty. So He sent His beautiful Son to this out-of-control earth to reveal His glory under the veil of human flesh, to show us what a truly God-centered and God-immersed life looks like, and to make it possible for us. And thanks to that child born on Christmas, we have a foot in the door of the new creation, courtesy of grace, and that really is good news worth telling. We learned that in the Gospel of Luke already, and then, a week after that, we began a journey further through Luke's account of the earliest earthly days of this Son of God. How He received the name Jesus, on the eighth day, the day He was circumcised, the day He submitted to the law on our account. We talked about how our flesh, fallen mortal since Adam, is so vulnerable, and yet we constantly trust in it. We build a lifestyle around trying to overcome fleshly limits with fleshly means. We learn how God instituted the covenant of circumcision with Abraham to enlist Israel in a fight against that kind of lifestyle called flesh. The covenant was meant to teach Israel the only way forward was not to trust in the power of their own flesh. The only way forward was to trust God to make His power, His strength, perfect in their weakness. The only hope was for God to bring life out of death. And so on the eighth day, still in Bethlehem, the baby Jesus was circumcised to join our fight, to give us His victory, to shed His blood so as to circumcise our hearts by His Spirit. Maybe you remember that if you were here those two Sundays. And now here we are, looking forward to another special day, another holiday coming up this week. Candlemas. We all know Candlemas. Okay, not. Candlemas is also known by a few other names. One is the Feast of the Purification of Mary. Another is the Feast of the Presentation of Our Lord. You see, Candlemas is the 40th day after Christmas. It's the day we commemorate the events of the story that Luke shared with us this morning in his Gospel, a story he learned from Mary herself. Why else do you always think he's saying that she treasured these things up in her heart? Mary told Luke this special story about the day of purification. See, under the law of Moses, after a child was born, the mother would be considered mildly, ritually unclean for a certain length of time. But after that time was up, she would take the child to the priests, and she would make an offering. It was a way to recognize the incredible power of a woman bringing new life into the world. That kind of power has to be handled, and it was through sacrifice that the Jews handled it. The normal offering was supposed to be a year-old lamb. But if you were too poor to afford a year-old lamb in those days, you could offer a pair of pigeons. That's exactly what Mary and Joseph do. Starting right here, Luke has a special heart for the poor and the downtrodden. Luke's main goal is to highlight the lawfulness of Jesus. Luke wants to emphasize that People who imitate Jesus will be respectful and valuable citizens. So Luke had portrayed Joseph obeying Roman law when Caesar says, travel for a census. That's exactly what Joseph did. Now Luke is saying they obeyed Jewish law too. In this short story, there are five references to what the law says, to the fact that they followed it. They're happy to follow the law, to the letter, for the glory of God. So Joseph and Mary travel to Jerusalem. It's about a 6-mile walk. There they go, carrying baby Jesus and a couple pigeons. When they get there, they climb their way up the steps to the temple courts, hoping to look for one of the priests always milling about. Just then, onto the scene pops another main character in Luke and Acts. Someone who's already made his appearance several times already. And that someone is the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is everywhere in this story. And this time the Holy Spirit has been at work on a local man named Simeon. Now Simeon lived in Jerusalem. By now he's a fairly old man. He's been waiting all his life for the Messiah to finally come, for God to make good on his promises of a righteous king who would rescue the people and answer all the problems of the Old Testament. The Holy Spirit has shown him, Simeon, unlike the generations before you, you will live to see the Messiah with your own eyes. Now the Holy Spirit prods Simeon to venture over the temple. Just the right time. Simeon's a pretty interesting character, actually. It doesn't tell us much about him here, unfortunately. Some Christians throughout the years have called him Saint Simeon the Prophet. No, make no mistake, that's what he is. Other Christians in the East call him Simeon the God Receiver, because he cradles God incarnate in his arms. Some scholars have actually suggested that we actually know who Simeon was. That this devout Jew named Simeon in Jerusalem is the same person as Shimeon ben Hillel, who at that time was the president of the Sanhedrin and the father of Paul's mentor, Gamaliel. It's entirely possible that's who Simeon was. It would be fitting. Whether that's true or not, in this account, both Simeon and an elderly prophetess named Anna, the daughter of a man named Phanuel, which is a name meaning the face of God, both of these prophets recognize baby Jesus for who he is. Luke wants us to know how devout both of them were, because the pious cream of the Jewish crop, unlike a later generation of Pharisees, were eager to see Jesus as the Messiah. Now, put yourself for a moment in Simeon's shoes. Imagine a few days before this story. Imagine you're living in those days, the days of the Roman occupation of Israel, the days when God seemed mostly silent. Not entirely, but largely, for centuries. Now, for decades and decades, you have wanted one thing above all else: for God to answer your prayers. And what you've been praying for the whole time is the same thing: for God to reveal himself, for God to send the Messiah, for God to set his redemption plan into action. Now, maybe Simeon was still a young man when the Holy Spirit first clued him in that he lived to see that day. Maybe he was my age. Can you imagine how excited Simeon was to know that all those generations throughout the centuries have been looking forward to this one thing long foretold by the prophets, and now he knows from God himself that it will happen in his very own lifetime, can you imagine? To know that all the suffering, Rome, sin, death, all of it is going to be changed forever. And he would live to finally meet the man who would make it happen. He would meet God's chosen one. He knows this. And then the years pass. Simeon grows up. His family, his children. He raised them. Maybe Gamaliel is one. We don't know. Simeon's wife passes away. He'd really hoped that she would get to share that exciting moment with him. But it wasn't to be so. And then more years pass. Now Simeon's wrestling with doubts. He wonders if maybe he misheard. He wonders if maybe he just made the whole thing up. He wonders if he's crazy. He wonders if he's mistaken. But he clings to faith. He still clings to faith. And more years go by. Decade after decade. He prays every day and every night. Tens of thousands of prayers. Now he's in his 80s or his 90s or maybe even older. His health isn't what it used to be. Breathing doesn't come so easily. He's starting to forget things here and there, little things around the house, you know. He has aches and pains in all sorts of places. He feels like he's just falling apart. He's struggling to get around. His hips just killing him. His back aches. And he looks back on the years and he says, you know what, I've had a good life. I really can't complain. I'd love to get some rest and call it a day. But I'm still waiting. I'm still waiting. Maybe the promise that excited him in his younger years was now almost starting to feel like a curse. A curse to keep living beyond what his worn-out body could bear. A curse to wait beyond his ability to wait. Decades before, when young Simeon first heard that word from the Spirit, he was so excited, but he never imagined it would take God that long to answer him. Simeon expected a timelier response to his prayers, but God made him wait and wait and wait and wait. Simeon waited beyond his life expectancy and then some. And there must have been times he felt like giving up. Have you ever felt that way? Have you ever felt like Simeon? Praying and praying and praying for something to happen, and it just seems like you and God have clocks that aren't even close to synchronized. Have you ever felt like you've been waiting around for God to do something and you aren't sure you can handle the wait anymore? Have you been tempted to give up hope? I know I have. And I'm sure I'll grow to identify more and more with Simeon as the years roll on. But remember one thing, just one thing, when the weight seems weightier than you can carry. Remember what Simeon learned firsthand in God's time. Remember that weight is not God speak for no. Wait is not God speak for no. The Spirit did not lie to Simeon. Simeon's prayers were not for nothing. They did not crash and splinter against the underside of the cloud-speckled firmament. Nor did they vanish into thin air. Simeon's prayers reached the ear of the God they were directed to, and that God set his time and gave a promise. And in his time, it was a promise he did fulfill. God did not make Simeon wait forever. It may have felt like that to Simeon some days, but it was not actually forever. God made good on his word and answered to Simeon's prayers. And he will do the same for us too. There may be times when God invites you to wait upon the Lord. And there will be times that waiting tries your patience. But wait is not God's speed for no. Simeon learned that firsthand. The Spirit prompted him one day, "Hey, today would be a fine day to go to the temple, don't you think, Simeon?" And so Simeon listens. He still carries that seed of faith, and he responds to the Spirit's prodding. He goes, and as he strides into the temple courts, he sees this young couple there. Now, that's not unusual. I mean, when you think about it, every day, I'm sure he sees plenty of couples carrying month-old baby boys, two-month-old baby girls into the temple courts with lamb or pigeons in tow. That happens all the time, all day, every day. It's what keeps the priests plenty busy. The temple is a bustling place. As Simeon looks around, his eyes alight on this one couple and the baby they hold, and the Spirit whispers to him, "There he is. There he is." And so Simeon limps and totters over as fast as his hips will let him. He intercepts Joseph and Mary, probably before they even reach a priest, and Simeon leans in and gently takes this Jesus in his frail and trembling arms. So Simeon looks down and he's holding the Messiah. He beholds the face of Jesus with his own eyes. And now, says Simeon, his life is complete. This was the one thing he'd been missing. And now he can die in peace with no regrets. Because wait was not God's speak for no. On that day, wait became God's speak for now. So through the Spirit, Simeon sang a song of praise. We'll get back to that song in a few minutes. But first, I am fascinated by what he says to Mary next. Oh, he's amazed at the couple with this strange intercession. He blesses them, of course, but then he offers a prophecy to Mary. And he says right there to young Mary's face, "Behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed. And a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed." That's such an important prophecy, but it sounds very cryptic. What's it mean? Well, first, notice the word Simeon uses for Jesus. Jesus will be a sign. That's the same word that the gospel writers always use for the miracles that Jesus performs. The miracles are signs. Jesus himself is a sign. His whole earthly life is a sign. This child will grow to be a walking miracle, a living pointer to God. And because he will be God's presence on earth, because he is the true temple, even now as he visits the temple, Jesus will be a sign that God's kingdom is opening for business at last. God the Father has appointed Jesus, the Messiah, his son, to make all the difference. His being here, his activity among us, will make all the difference. Because Jesus, the unexpected working of God, will expose what's really in us. Jesus will unmask every hypocrite, every human. Jesus will reveal the real devotion or the real faithlessness inside each of us. Whether or not we really carry faith, hope, and love in our hearts. For so many years, the prophets criticized the people. They knew that the oppressive bigwigs of society were empty on the inside, some of them at least. We know from the Gospels that Jesus unmasked those impressive leaders as really being more like whitewashed tombs. See, whitewashed tombs are so pretty on the outside. But when you open them up, you find that they're inwardly filthy, as if they're full of the stinking bones of the dead. That's what was really in their hearts. Jesus brings these kinds of things to light. There's no pretending around Jesus as much as many of our brothers and sisters would like to pretend when they're in church. When Jesus comes near, all the masks fall off. Everything outward, all the posturing of the prominent, all the ordinary lowliness of the seemingly average, everything outward becomes see-through at last. Around Jesus, there's no prospect for pretended piety. The truth of who you are will be brought out. Nor around Jesus is there the risk of lingering false shame, because the truth will be brought out. The real person, the person of the heart, will be exposed, whether pretty or dead men's bones. And that sort of exposure is an incredibly disruptive thing, don't you think? Our lives, like their lives then, are built around conventions. We so often say what we don't mean, and we don't say what we do mean. We go through certain agreed upon motions to be socially accepted. And we look upon outward appearances. A nice church person of the upper middle class, socially active, involved in the community, well, we assume that's an example to follow. But if you have a struggling divorced mom of three barely making ends meet, well, you think if only she could be more like that guy. When Jesus comes around, maybe he exposes the prideful self-satisfaction of that guy's heart and the sincere desperation for God in hers. Or vice versa. When Jesus comes around, he disrupts all the outward markers that we use to classify and categorize the social world around us. All the things we look for and make assumptions about people, Jesus breaks them down. He remakes the social hierarchy. He reconstitutes it based on the heart, the inward deliberations of the heart. And for some people, says Simeon, that will result in their falling. The word Luke uses here is the same word that Matthew uses at the end of the Sermon on the Mount. Remember that story about the house that was built on sand? What happens when the wind and the rain come and the house crashes down into rubble? That's the word Luke uses here. This child is pointed in such a way that that will happen for many in Israel. But for some people, what Jesus exposes in their hearts will be different. For other people, Jesus disrupting will result in their rising, their resurrection from their deadened lives, the flight of their position, when they just grab his hand and let him pull them up to where they really belong in their hearts. Jesus changes everything. Now naturally, those whose exposure is less than pretty, those whose downward tumble will be less than pleasant, are not going to be thrilled by the presence of Jesus, the revealer of hearts. To many in the world, Jesus is a threat. And so it's no surprise Simeon describes him as a sign that is opposed, a sign that gets spoken against and criticized and objected to, finally by lethal violence. That's no surprise. And Simeon warns Mary that a sword would pierce through her own soul also. Now, you may think, oh, that's a little prick, but the word Luke uses for sword is not exactly the word for a butter knife. The word shows up about 7 times in the New Testament, I think. The other 6 are all in Revelation. That gives you a sense of the kind of sword you might be describing. This is not a delicate kind of sword. It's the kind of sword you'll see William Wallace swing in Braveheart as he bellows about freedom. It's that kind of sword. This is a nasty, heavy, Highland broadsword, like a Highland claymore. And for people like Mary who love this Jesus, loving him means having grief pangs skewer your soul like a broadsword. If you've ever felt emotional pain like that, Mary can relate. That's the cost of Jesus changing everything. Down to our own day, Jesus is disrupting things. Down to our own day, Jesus is exposing hearts. What, I wonder, will he reveal about others? If we offer our hearts to Jesus, as we profess every Sunday that we do, but if we really offer our hearts into his hand, into his care, so that he can shed his light on them, will we like what we see? The more important question is actually, will he like what he sees? He's the revealer of hearts and their judge. Back to Simeon, though. Here stands Simeon in the temple courts. The baby in his arms, the very presence that lit up the Holy of Holies. This here is the Messiah. This here is the consolation of Israel. This here is the living presence of the redemption of Jerusalem. This here is light and salvation. This here is Jesus. Messiah, Savior, and King. Both Simeon and Anna proclaim it. Here in this moment, as the Lord is presented to the Lord, Jesus goes public. That's what Simeon is saying in his song. Master, you are now letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. Think about that. Think about that. What Simeon is seeing with his own eyes in the face of this little baby, is not God's salvation prepared in secret? Jesus is not God's salvation off in a corner. Jesus is not God's salvation behind a wall. Jesus is not God's salvation under wraps. Jesus is light and salvation prepared in the presence of all peoples. Jesus is God's salvation in public. And Jesus is God's public salvation presented to the public. Jesus is God's salvation for Israel. He's their consolation. He's their redemption. He's the light that brings them glory. Just the same, Jesus is God's salvation for every other nation. Every people that once was far from God and dead in sin. Jesus is their light of revelation. That's what he's all about. He's about revealing. He reveals our hearts to us, but more than that, Jesus reveals God's heart to those who never really knew God at all. And what we find when Jesus' light shining out of God's heart is that God's heart is salvation. God's heart is a loving and heroic feat of costly rescue. God's heart is salvation to the uttermost degree for those at the uttermost removed from him, as we all once were, and as some of our neighbors out here yet are. Jesus is light and salvation. That day at the temple, Jesus Christ was presented to us. He was offered by Joseph and Mary to God, and offered by God back to all humanity. Offered by God back to us to be our salvation. Jesus was presented in our presence. Now the question is, will we seek to be present where he is? Will we return again and again to the temple, the fellowship of the saints, to meet him here? Will we do that? And will we then go forth, led by the Spirit as Simeon was, to be present with Jesus, the Messiah, on mission throughout the week? Will we be present as he is present? Jesus Christ went public for us. He went public that day as the Messiah. He went public as God's light and salvation. Now the question is, he went public for us. Will we go public for him? Will we receive him and celebrate him as publicly as he was publicly acclaimed Messiah? As publicly as he became salvation for us? That's a lot of questions. All those questions, those are our questions to answer. Luke does not write down in the next verse what each of us will do. Luke has shared Mary's story with us. Ours is the response. The response between us and God and each other. May we, like Anna, go forth from God's house today to give thanks to God and to speak of him to all who are waiting. Waiting for God's redemptive power to work in their lives also. May we now present Jesus Christ, the long-awaited salvation of God. And may we, the church, ever go public to present him to our world and to each other. Hallelujah. Gracious Father, we give you thanks and bless your holy name, for you have sent your Son into the world. Through the long years of waiting, you kept your word. And now we may go forth in peace. We go forth to proclaim that we have seen a light. Let us shine that light, the light of Jesus Christ, the light of the Messiah, our Lord and Savior, to all who are still waiting. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Move us along our way. And shine through us.